spite of what I see, Lord, I believe. But help my unbelief, I choose to trust you. No matter what I feel, let faith arise. Let faith arise. For my champion's not dead, he is alive. Oh, and he already knows my every need. Surely he will come and rescue me. God of miracles, come, we need your supernatural love to break through. Nothing's impossible. You're the God of miracles. like the frost on a rose. Winter comes for us all. Oh, how nature acquaints us with the nature of patience. Like a seed in the snow, I've been buried to grow. For your promise is loyal, from sea to sequoia. I know, though the winter is long, even richer than the harvest it brings. Though my waiting prolongs, even greater your promise for me, like a seed. I believe that my season will come. Lord, I think of your love like the low winter sun. And as I gaze, I am blinded in the light of your brightness. And like a fire to the snow, I'm renewed in your warmth. Melt the ice of this wild soul till
Church. My name's Greg Zettner, and I was just going to bring you a few thoughts I had on the Last Supper and what occurred there and when Jesus was teaching his disciples. When Jesus had this final meal before he faced the cross, he said in Luke 22:15, "I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer." He was looking forward to this meal. It was a very busy meal. a lot on his plate. Jesus had a lot on his plate, no pun intended. The biggest thing, the cross was the next day. That pressure must have been so weighing on our Lord. He still had lessons that he wanted to teach his disciples, things that he wanted to impart to them. And Jesus said the Holy Spirit would bring things to remembrance. This meal was going to be jam-packed, and he wanted the disciples to remember it. So he was going to rely on the Holy Spirit to bring things to their remembrance after he was died and raised again, so that they would be able to write this down so that we could have what went on at this meal. I didn't realize how much is recorded of this meal, but in the Gospel of John, from chapters 13 to 17, all concerns what went on during this meal. It was, again, it was just a jam-packed time that Jesus put so much into. A couple of the teachings that Jesus had given during this meal, that Jesus overcomes the world, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, that he is the vine and we are the branches. He was explaining these things to his disciples during the meal. And people have been comforted by these verses for centuries. And Jesus had them all presented in one meal. Only God could be facing the cross the next day and still have the presence and peace of mind to do all this. He impacted his disciples with valuable lessons. He washed his disciples' feet to teach humility and that they should serve one another. He instituted the Lord's Supper, something that we continue to do today, that the bread represents his body and the wine his blood. And he called Judas out for going to betray him. I know, personally speaking, if I've been given one or two things to do during a meal, like say grace or introduce someone, I have a hard time even thinking about the meal. I'm thinking about what I have to do. And Jesus was able to do assortment of things and bless people in this meal, that he should be under, you know, people should be supporting him because he was under so much pressure at the time. It says, one part of the gospel message, it says about this meal that there was something during the meal that troubled his spirit, and it was Judas's betrayal. One of the reasons I think Jesus pointed out Judas's betrayal during the meal before it occurred, it would show that his disciples that he was in control, that nothing happened that he wasn't aware of. And he called Judas out in a number of ways. He said, "It's the one I give this piece of bread after I dipped it," and he gave it to Judas. And Judas directly asked Jesus, "Is it I, Rabbi?" when they were all asking who it was that was going to betray him. And Jesus answered, "You have said so." So he right publicly in front of everyone, of the other disciples, he basically stated that Judas was the betrayer. And all this occurred around the time Jesus was instituting the First Communion. The first time there ever was communion, the betrayal of Jesus by Judas was taking place at the same time. 1 Corinthians 11:27 says the following, "Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord." Judas is an example of this, verse. He fulfilled it. Jesus sums up Judas's state and his life like this: "It would have been better for that man if he had not been born." What a sad statement. But even with that going on, Jesus said during the meal in John 14:27, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you." Now that's God promises us his peace, and that's a supernatural peace. Jesus had peace with this all going on around him, the betrayal, the cross impending, and he had a peace, and he wants to give that to us. That's a supernatural peace that goes beyond our circumstance, and it's only God can give us that. And praise God, he promises us that in John here. And one of the reasons Jesus is at peace is he has an eternal perspective. He's looking into eternity. He sees that. And he knew he was heading back to his Father, and he was excited about that. You know, he was concerned and about the cross and very anxious, I assume, but he was truly excited that he was about to leave this world and go back to his Father. Jesus knew about the future, and he used this to help his disciples at that time. And he wanted to minister them and strengthen them. Peter is an example. He said to him, "Simon, Simon, behold, Satan demanded to have you, that he might sift you like wheat. But I have prayed for you, that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned again, strengthen your brothers." Jesus told Peter that he would deny him three times, but to hold on to his faith. So Jesus calls out Peter's failures for a number of reasons, but he calls them out even before they happened to show us that he is greater than our failures. It doesn't matter if we fail, Jesus can bring us through that, that he is sovereign. It also says in Luke 22:24, "A dispute arose among them," that's the disciples, "as to which of them was to be regarded as the greatest." This, I assume, is probably when Jesus washed their feet, just as a humble example of their Lord and Savior washed their feet. They needed that lesson, and we do too. We need to be humble and servant. No one lines up to be a servant, but Jesus showed us that we should. But he also showed the future to these disciples and what lay ahead of them. And it was a great promise. But Jesus said to them, "I assign to you a kingdom that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom and sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel." What a great promise. These men were gonna sit on thrones with Jesus in his kingdom. This meal had a lot going on. It's really hard to keep track. There was things that Jesus did that would definitely have taken a lifetime for some people to do, and he was able to do it in the space of a meal. In movies, you often see a scene where someone's dying and they want to give someone some lasting advice. Well, Jesus did that during the meal too. He did that during the Last Supper. Sometimes this Thursday is called Maundy Thursday, and Maundy is a Latin term which means commandment. And during the meal, after Judas had left at this point, he had left the meal, Jesus gave the remaining 11 disciples a new commandment, he called it. And we find it in John 13:34-35. "A new commandment I give you, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also are to love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." Loving each other is important. Jesus, and one of the last things he did when he had time with his disciples before he went to the cross, is tell them that it's very important to love each other. And he wants to tell us that too. It's very important for us to love each other. And another aspect to this meal has to do with Jesus praying. And Jesus often prayed during his ministry. You hear in the Gospels when he would look for a quiet place to go off to pray to his Father. He'd get up early and head out to pray to his Father. And his disciples often heard him pray. And they wanted to learn from him. And they asked him, "Lord, teach us to pray." And that's when God taught them how they should pray with the Our Father. And so the disciples often heard him pray. And it was just very much a part of Jesus that he prayed during his ministry. And after the meal, when he had finished, he had done teaching his disciples, he had confronted Judas with his betrayal, he instituted the communion, talked to Peter and the other disciples, and then he prays. It's sometimes called the high priestly prayer, and it's found in the Gospel of John, and it's the whole chapter 17. That's just his prayer is recorded. And this is how it starts. John 17. "When Jesus had spoken these words, he lifted up his eyes to heaven and said," so he just, after the meal, he had done what he wanted, and he just stopped and he looked up and he started talking to his Heavenly Father with the 11 disciples listening. So it was just an open prayer that he just talked to God, and the 11 disciples were listening to it as he talked. And they remembered his words. The Holy Spirit brought it to remembrance. They remembered his words and they wrote it down in John 17. And it's an amazing prayer. Jesus prays for himself. He prays for his disciples. And then he prays for us, you and me, in the future, people that would believe in Jesus according to their testimony. this week when I was driving home from work, I was sort of thinking about this message and just how much he had accomplished in one meal. And I just happened to be driving over a place and I could see the hills and the ocean and a beautiful sky. And I just thought, what a good job you did at that meal. You did so much stuff. And then it struck me funny. Of course it was a good job. It was God who was doing it. And I kind of smiled to myself, and it was sort of like the finite, me, trying to figure out the infinite, God. And he's a great God that we serve. He's more than capable, and we are in his hands. And he knows our future, and he knows our past, he knows our failures, our mistakes, but he still loves us, and he died for us. And I just pray, Lord, that we all may be comforted at this time, Lord, as we're apart and we don't have a physical opportunity to show our love for each other. That you just guide us and lead us to people that need your love. And we thank you for your love. And I just thank you that you all tuned in and that we could spend this time together. Goodbye.
Sing together, Father in heaven. Father in heaven, holy is your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Our Father in temptation, but God deliver us from the enemy. Yours is the kingdom. And then